Date is January 19th, 1997. Liberator is Dr. Brendon Phibbs. The interviewer is Louise Bobro. The city is Tucson in the state of Arizona. Country is United States of America, and the language is in English. My name is Louise Bobro, B-O-B-R-O-W. Today's date is January 19th, 1997. I am conducting an interview with Liberator Dr. Brendon Phibbs. The interview is being conducted in Tucson, Arizona, in the United States of America. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
What is your complete name?
Brendon Pierce Phibbs.
Would you kindly spell that?
B-R-E-N-D-A-N, first name. Pierce, P-E-A-R-S-E. Phibbs, P-H-I-B-B-S. The middle name is for Padre Pierce, the Irish patriot who was killed by the English. Had to slip that one in.
That was your name at birth?
Yes.
Do you have any nicknames?
Just shortening of Brendon to Brennan Bran or something like that. Red when I was a cowboy at the age of 16 up in Wyoming when I had red hair.
What is your birth date?
December 3rd, 1916.
How old are you today?
I was 80 last month.
Where were you born?
Yonkers, New York, outside New York City.
What was your father's name?
Harry Clandillon Phibbs, C-L-A-N-D-I-L-L-O-N, old Irish connection.
What was his occupation?
He owned an advertising agency in Chicago. He came here as a young artist from Ireland at the age of 20-some, landed with the equivalent of $25 in his pocket, didn't know a soul in the Western Hemisphere up in Newfoundland, and did many things, ended up owning a medical advertising agency that did professional advertising in Chicago.
How would you describe him?
He was short, endlessly enthusiastic, dedicated to arts, culture, the outdoors, imaginative. Could be a stern father when he so chose, in the old country tradition.
What was your mother's name?
Mother's name was Therese Kelly. She was from Galway, Loughrea, Galway, Ireland. And she died when I was only 8 years old of breast cancer.
Did she have an occupation?
Pardon? No, she's a housewife. Actually, she did. She helped my father start his business. She was his secretary and entire office staff when they opened the Harry C. Phibbs Advertising Agency with $200 in the bank and made it.
And can you describe your mother?
She's tall, very pretty, dark, very vivacious. Yeah.
Any special fond memories you'd like to tell about your parents?
Oh, let me think. I can remember my mother singing a favorite song to me as a little boy and leading me through the forests of a place in Indiana where we had a cabin on Lake Michigan. And I remember my father tactfully organizing wolf hunts near this cabin there weren't wolves, of course. But I was solemnly presented with a sharpened stick when I was 6 years old and told go out wolf hunting. And I'd hear wolves howling. Sure enough, you'd hear wolves howling all around and so on. They organized kind of a magic life for a little boy in many ways.
Do you have any siblings?
I have one brother. My sister is dead, my older sister, 4 years old. She died of cancer some years ago. My young half-brother, Rod, my father remarried some years later, and is a very famous pediatrician, one of the most famous in the world. He's the head of the newborn department at the University of California. He lives out near San Francisco.
And what is his name?
Roderick.
Was your brother in the military?
Rod was never in the military. He kind of was just the wrong age for everything. He was a little boy in World War II. He's 15 years younger than I am. So he fell out between all the different wars.
What schools did you attend?
Went to the usual grammar schools in Chicago and went to DePaul High School, taught by the Vincentian brothers in the near north side of Chicago. My father's family are all Church of Ireland, Anglican, which is High Episcopalians. My mother's were Catholics, and I naturally took to my father's church, but out of respect to my mother, I went to Catholic schools. So I went to a boys' school taught by Vincentian brothers.
So you moved from Yonkers to Chicago?
I grew up in Chicago. We moved there as a little tiny child.
So you attended through high school?
Yes. And then went to Northwestern University, pre-med, and medical school.
Was that all before the war?
Before the war, yes.
How would you describe then your religious upbringing?
Say that again.
Were you raised a Catholic or were you raised Episcopalian?
Well, I was raised between two churches, actually. The church I liked was St. James Episcopal Cathedral, where a nice old lady used to give me scotch bread. But to keep my mother's sister and others happy, I would pro forma go to the Catholic school. So I'm kind of an expert on theology in a couple of lines.
How much did you know about Jews and Judaism growing up?
Oh, lots. Because we lived first on the middle north side of Chicago, Albany, Ravenswood area. And there were many, many of the Jews who had left Russia in the pogroms had settled there. So I remember seeing the Hebrew letters on stores. This is on Montrose Avenue and that part of Chicago. And many of my playmates were Jewish boys. And some of my father's closest friends were Jews who were in the medical publishing, Mal and Jay Hers of Minneapolis and others. And so I remember sitting around our huge dining room table with the silver and the crystal and long discussions of the theater and the books and letters. That's when I decided, I was teasing some Jewish friends of mine not long ago, said, you can't be Jewish and be conservative. Sorry. Jewish means humanistic, cultured, progressive, forward-looking, liberal. But that's what it was around our house anyway.
What was the prevailing attitude amongst the non-Jews in your community towards Jews when you were growing up?
Well, there's some mindless anti-Semitism, I think, among little boys that didn't know what they were saying. They yell, oi, 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 Ganzevelt, just as a war cry as they ran down the street throwing rocks at each other. But they didn't know what the words meant, but they'd heard them. Beyond that, I don't think there was anything very vocal or deliberate or organized.
Were you involved in any organizations prior to the war?
Just the Democratic Party, to the great discomfort of my father, who thought that anyone who was a New Deal Roosevelt Democrat was right on the skirts of Moscow or something. But that was about the size of it.
What were your hobbies?
Outdoors, all my life, besides reading, avid reading. But we used to go on canoe trips in Ontario. We had a summer home in the Indiana sand dunes, which was very wild country then. And even as a little boy, I could take care of myself in the forest. I learned how to paddle a canoe, how to live in the woods. And the summer I got out of high school, through some connections, I had a job as a $30 a month cowboy on a ranch near Cody, Wyoming. I mean, a real cattle ranch where I really worked my little teenage tail off. But that's the outdoors, literature, music. I love music all my life. Even though I don't play a piano very well, I collect music.
Did you play any other instrument?
Just the piano. I tried the violin, it was enough to make you forswear music forever. We finally gave it away to our worst enemy, I think.
Did you always aspire as a youngster to be a doctor?
Yes, ever since I was a little boy, it seemed perfectly natural that that's what I was supposed to be.
Did you marry prior to entering the military?
Yes, I was married my senior year in medical school. Penny, my wife, who was from a New York family. An old New England, old American. Actually, she was from a descendant of the first settlers at Nantucket, the Coffins.
What was her name?
Coffin. Well, her name was Harl, but they're direct descendants of Tristram Coffin, the original 16-something man on Nantucket, old American.
Did you have children before you went?
Yes, we had. After I went in the military, not before. Yeah.
So after you went into the military, what did your wife do?
She was an Army wife. She lived in Army camps with us. Had two children.
When did you enter the military?
Well, it was shortly after Pearl Harbor. I interned this in the year July 1, 41 to July 1, 42. That's how the internship years run, July to July. And we had all registered for the draft already. So we knew we'd be going into service sometime. But December 7th came along. And in the horrible weeks after that, we were losing the war so badly all over the Pacific and everywhere else in the world. Then I went down to 5th Army headquarters, about February, I guess it was, and said, look, I want to get sworn in. I want to do everything I can to facilitate this. So they said delighted at Northwestern University, St. Luke's Hospital, Chicago, which is where I was interning. And I was a first lieutenant, Army United States Medical Corps. I got my orders. They said, finish your internship, and then you'll get your orders. So I got my orders on August 1st, 1942, to the Medical Field Service School at Carlisle Barracks, Pennsylvania.
Is that where you received then your basic training?
Basic training.
And was there any specialized training there?
Well, it was specialized for medical officers. That's what it was. It was the headquarters of the Medical Corps of the U.S. Army. So they showed, beside teaching us marching and drill and push-ups and the usual nonsense, we learned how the medical support of fighting units was ordered. This is a school for doctors who would be with combat units, not with hospitals or anything like that.
And how long were you there?
Just a month.
And then where did you go after that?
Then I was assigned to the 12th Armored Division at Camp Campbell, Tennessee.
And your rank at this time?
First Lieutenant.
So you went to?
To Camp Campbell.
Campbell.
And I spent 2 years, we spent 2 years in training. And it takes about 2 years to really train a division, especially an armored division with a lot of specialist skills involved.
What were you specifically training there for?
Well, we were training as armored force medics. We had to learn vehicle maintenance. We had half tracks, which is half armored and half wheels, as well as regular cross-country ambulances, jeeps, weapons carry. We had to learn weapons, convoy discipline, care of the wounded under difficult situations, blackout, how to set up an aid station in the forest or in a cellar or something and black it out from enemy air and enemy patrols, and frontline surgery. But we were very frontline, so what we did was pretty fast.
So your unit was called the
12th Armored Division.
12th Armored Division. And who was your commanding officer?
The final man who took us into battle was Roderick Allen, General Roderick Allen.
The members of your unit, where were they from?
Mostly Northerners. They were from Pennsylvania, Illinois. We had some hillbillies from the Appalachian area. And a few Texans who always took a lot of ribbing because we sent our second year in training was at Camp Barkley, Texas, west of Abilene, which is a pretty dismal place, as we never tired pointing out to the Texans in our division.
Were there Jews in your unit?
Oh, yes, many of them. In the medical battalion, the medical, because many of them have been looking at professional careers. We have many Jews in the battalion as medical officers and dental officers. And then scattered through the division was about pretty good cross-section of American population, except for the fact that we were segregated. There were no blacks at that point. We had a segregated army in World War II.
How many doctors would you say were you?
Well, let me think. There were three infantry battalions, which had two surgeons each, that's six. There were three tanks, which was one man each, which is nine. Excuse me, I'm fighting the flu. Three artillery battalions, so it would be 12. And there were about, one recon's 13. The medical battalion, there were three companies, 12, 20-some physicians total, I would guess, in the division. Excuse me. I'm fighting the current version of the flu for a few days. So I have to cough. I'm sorry.
Do you recall any episodes of anti-Semitism within your unit?
Gosh, I don't think so, because we had so many Jewish officers in the unit, and that is in the medical battalion. In the unit, generally, not anything overt that I can ever recall, no.
So did everyone in the unit get along well?
Oh, yeah. Everyone was accepted on the basis of how he performed as an officer. In the Army, you can't disguise things very much.
Who were your friends?
Well, in combat, finally, when I went overseas, my closest friend was a man named Clarence Sabrowski, who is now a lawyer in Green Bay, Wisconsin. And some of the pictures we're going to see today were taken by him. He's the signal officer of our combat command headquarters. And a man we nicknamed Pancho Punsky, who now lives in New York. And we called him Pancho so long I forgot what Punsky's first name was. But he was a Jewish boy from New York who we used to say looked and talked like Groucho Marx, even in combat. He's a very good man. Those two of my closest friends, I guess, in the Army. And then we had our little, before I went overseas, I was promoted. First I made captain, company commander, and then I made major over in Normandy. And I went overseas, I got promoted forward, which not only up but forward, which meant on the line. I was the surgeon of an armored combat command.
What did you know about the treatment of Jewish and non-Jewish civilians in Europe at the time, before you went over?
Yeah. Well, there was no secret about what had been going on in Germany. I think we all knew about the Kristallnacht, and we knew that there was a place called Dachau. In fact, there was a movie made about that showed Dachau, a popular movie, and I can't remember who all was in it, but based on a novel by an English novelist. Nobody had any idea of the extent of the killing that was going on, the scale of what we did. We knew that there were the people, that the treatment of Jews was, of course, brutal, that they were, to use a loose word, discriminated against, and that they were losing their property, that they were put into camps. And that's about as far as anybody knew. The organized killing that went on was kind of a secret in the Western world, at least to me and to my friends.
When did you ship out?
Pardon?
What year did you ship out?
We shipped over in September 44.
What ship were you on?
Well, it was a Liberty ship. Who knows what? There were little squat tubs that we sailed across. We sailed in a convoy, escorted by Canadian corvettes, which are like in a cruiser. We were shadowed by a German submarine wolf pack most of the way, and we could hear the depth bombs going off against the ships. We landed in England, and our division reassembled at the old British cavalry barracks near Salisbury, England, Salisbury Plain, classical military place. We spent a month in England picking up new tanks with higher velocity guns and retraining, and then we crossed the channel, landed at Cherbourg, and Eisenhower couldn't quite decide which way to send our division. First, we heard we were going up north to Holland, but then they decided to send us in a big chase across France, chasing the Germans toward the German border. And we caught up with them toward the end of November, just as they turned and started their bloody fighting in the Siegfried Line and the Maginot Line positions.
What major battles did your unit engage in?
Oh, the big ones we have battle stars for are called Ardennes, Alsace, Rhineland, Central Europe. They give you a campaign star for each campaign. We started out fighting our way through the old French Maginot Line forts from the wrong side, the ones that the French couldn't hold against the Germans. As the Germans retreated, they dug in their tanks behind these 20-foot concrete pillboxes, and we were attacking through heavy mud all along the German-Lorraine border. In our first battle, we went over the border, attacked the little place called Utweiler, Germany, the first town in Germany that our division liberated. They have a big sign, "You're entering Germany courtesy of the 12th Armored Division," and so on. And then we stopped on the line at Christmas, and just heavy lines slugging through mud and pillboxes and burning villages, very heavy fighting. And then we're told to hold in place, but we didn't know it, but the Belgian bulge had broken out right on our left flank. So the division next to us, 3rd Army, went up to attack the bulge. They were part of Patton's 3rd Army. We stretched our lines and held in place. And then when the Belgian bulge slowed down, decided to lose its impetus, Hitler and his generals switched to the Alsace-Lorraine, the second phase of the bulge, to try and take it back. And we were alerted for movement. The 7th Army, which held that end of the front, was a veteran group. They'd been in Italy. They'd fought their way up from Marseille. They were well prepared, and they didn't get caught on the wrong foot the way the boys did in Belgium. So part of their attempt to take Alsace back was a bridgehead across the Rhine, north of Strasbourg. Strasbourg, the capital of Alsace, is right on the Rhine. The Germans held a bridgehead below it, the city of Colmar, a large piece of land, and they attacked several different directions. One was just north, 15 miles north of Strasbourg, across the Rhine, to link up with their other forces. So we went through the Vosges Mountains and attacked the Germans. And we were our one division was up against something like 3 German divisions. It was heavy fighting, the coldest winter in 40 years, deep snow, and we stopped them. And we were down to our last 50 rounds of ammunition for the guns the night that they finally got halted. And we had lost one whole tank battalion, but we destroyed more German tanks than we lost. So, but it was, and getting the wounded out was a nightmare sometimes.
What was that like? How to help?
Pardon?
Do you recall any experiences of getting the wounded out? What?
Well, the way we operated, battalion aid means you're on the line. I was the surgeon of an armored combat command. That's a third of an armored division. A battalion of tanks, a battalion of armored infantry who ride in half tracks with machine guns and mortars, a battalion of self-propelled artillery and then supporting troops like engineers and medics, 3,000 men. And each battalion had its own doctor, sometimes two, at their own aid station. They'd been set up in ruined buildings or cellars pretty close to 300 or 400 yards from the front line. And we're getting shelled all the time, of course. And we have to wait until there's a break in shelling and then make a run for it with an ambulance, with to cram in the wounded and then go. We had one of the terrifying things is when you have an aid station full of wounded men crying and groaning and screaming, then they start shelling it again. The roof starts coming in. It was very bloody fighting. We were up against SS troops, the 10th SS Division. We learned that they are totally criminals. They trapped one of our aid men and killed him. I wrote about this in my book. There was an American wounded boy lying out in the snow crying for help. As the other aid men say, kind of like a little kid. And there had been a German machine gun covering the position. It's random spurts. But one of the aid men, a brave little boy from New York, excuse me, said, "I can't stand listening to that guy cry anymore. I got to go." So he ran out waving a Red Cross at noon on bright snow on a clear day. He knelt down bandaging him, and the SS man waited till he was all tied up, and then he cut him in two with a machine gun. This came close to home because one of our patrols crawled up and threw a hand grenade in, and the SS trooper tried to grab the hand grenade and blew his hand off, so we got hold of him. And I saw him at the rear aid station where I happened to be driving through. I didn't know what had happened. Here's this SS trooper with a bloody stump. His right hand was gone. So I asked him the usual questions. I speak fluent German. And I said, "Hab Spritz gehabt? Have you had a shot?" "Yeah." "Gib Spritz?" "Nein." "Heck with you, Herman. Okay, we've taken care of you." I shipped him out, but a little while later, the battalion surgeon came in looking to kill him because they knew who he was. Unfortunately, he got sent back to a nice big American hospital where he got treated with love, tenderness, sympathy. He's probably back home in Germany telling him what a brave guy he was or something like that.
Do you recall any other incidents while you were in these major battles that you'd like to talk about?
Well, I can remember the night the Germans did something stupid. That's always fun to think about. They somehow got the word that we had retreated all the way to the Vosges Mountains. We were down near the Rhine. And they came marching in, columns of fours, yelling commands right into our machine guns. And our tanks went out there, and they were screaming, "Doc, Doc, get up here, get up here." I was trying to get my ambulance toward the battle through a column of tanks. I remember the fireworks flaring and the shells going off. We were winning a battle, a very large one. But the hairiest part of that battle was our last day on the line, which was the 19th of January, in that battle, the Germans counterattacked with 50 tanks, Tiger tanks mostly, big ones, came right across the plain toward our command post. We were all watching through field glasses. Our tanks were over on the other flank of the bridgehead, so there's nothing out there except a few machine gunners. And our artillery observers called down artillery, and they knocked out some of the Germans. And our little headquarters detachment was out there with its one bazooka and a few machine guns and carbines to try and stop the 10th SS Panzer Division. And just in the nick of time, our tank battalion came roaring from the other flank, went out there and took them on, drove them off. The Rhine fog came in. But it was a very tense thing that afternoon. That night, we beat it off. The Germans veered off to the south, and another battalion of our tanks caught them in what we call defilade. They were down, concealed, and they knocked out a whole column of German tanks. So we stopped it for that day. But the German wounded, whom I talked to frequently, they told me everything. They were happy to be taken care of, so we got a lot of intelligence. That tomorrow comes the big attack. Tiger tanks, two battalions upon, right here, right at this command. "Please get me out of here, doctor. Get me out of here to the rear." So we were all ready for them, we thought. And then that was the time of the big ammunition shortage. The Pentagon miscalculated. After the victories in Normandy and France, they thought the war was going to be over, so they stopped shipping ammunition, if you can believe it.
What year are we talking about?
44, 45. They thought they were over-optimistic. Suddenly, our guns were short of ammunition, and about 10 o'clock that night, We got the dismal news in our basement command post that there are only 50 more rounds of ammunition for all our guns, and then we're out. The nearest resupply was Paris, 200 miles away. And we knew the German attack was coming the next morning. So it was pretty tense along the line that night. Everyone was counting bullets. And then we got a phone call, and our intelligence officer, who was a Texan himself, got almost hysterically so happy that the Texas National Guard, the 36th Infantry Division, which had been in reserve, 12,000 men, 15,000 men with tanks, guns, stuff, came marching up through the snow. We could all ran outside to see these figures coming through the falling snow. That was the nicest thing I've ever seen in my life. We went off the line. Out of 1,000 infantrymen we went on the line with, we went off with 120, 130. We're still walking when we left. That's been 2 weeks of fighting.
What were your specific duties as a doctor? Were you a surgeon? Did you do surgery?
Well, we did up front line. Every doctor is called a surgeon in the Army. It doesn't mean you're a specialist or anything. We were front line. We would get the wounded, sometimes run out and get them ourselves, or go with the aid men, get them in some, and get our job to set up an aid station as close to the line as we could. It came as a real shock in the Medical Field Service School in 1942, and they said, gentlemen, we all thought we'd be in a hospital or something. He said, gentlemen, be sure to get the wounded and defilade. And we said, what's defilade? He said, that's out of the line of direct fire from machine guns. So he said, oh, yeah, okay. So you get them in shelter, like a cellar. In Europe, we'd find these ruined buildings, cellars, holes. There's always something to crawl into, cover it over, and get a little stove going for heat for the wounded. And the aid men would bring them in on the half tracks and litter jeeps. We'd stop bleeding, splint bones, sometimes amputate limbs, and give blood plasma. They couldn't give blood that far forward in those days, but they had plasma, which is made up in a powdered bottle. And you diluted it with a vacuum bottle, and then you could stick a soldier rifle in the ground by the bayonet, hang the plasma and run it in by vein. We could do things like that. And it was very frontline, very rough, immediate life-saving intervention is what we did. And then we got them to the rear as fast as we could.
Did you have all the necessary supplies always that you needed?
Yeah, we had. Well, we had to improvise. The old Army Medical Corps between wars was archaic. It was the refuge of the incompetent. We had stuff that hadn't been used since the Spanish-American War in 1900. But we got good modern stuff when we went overseas. We had sulfa drugs and didn't have penicillin yet, and bandages and splints, and we improvised a lot.
And you had anesthesia?
Well, we could use pentothal by vein, or chloroform, the old-fashioned anesthetic. Two or three quick whiffs of chloroform, you could set a bone quickly and let them come out of it.
How did you deal with battle, personally?
I was scared all the time, but you had to do what you had to do, as they say nowadays, so I did it. But it's a terrifying experience, let me tell you. And it's worse and sicker. As I described in my book, the first man I saw killed, when I suddenly realized what this is all about. It's back in the line in December. I looked out the window of my aid station, a shell went off, or the big explosion. Someone screamed, medics, medics. I grabbed my helmet and my aid kit and ran out across the field. And I yelled, where's the casualty? And the hands came up out of foxholes and pointed, over there, Doc. And then they all got back in their foxholes. I suddenly realized, when you're a medic, you go out and get the wounded. And an aid man and I got to this boy, and his face was all blood. And I was dabbing out, looking for the wound. The aid man kept trying to babble at me. I couldn't understand what he said. And he said, Major, Major. And I said, what? He ain't got no back on his head. And we turned him over, and the whole back of his head had been sheared off. His brains ran out in my lap. So we put him down, and we knew there'd be another shell coming in a minute. And sure enough, I dived out. I heard the next shell coming. I dived for the ground so fast, I dived out from under my helmet. And I ran back to the command post cellar, diving under tanks and things. And that's when you suddenly realize what war is. Somebody's brains running out on the ground.
We have to stop this tape, and we'll continue with the next tape. 19th, 1997. Dr. Phibbs, we left off on the last tape. I had asked you how it was for you being in battle, and you cited an experience with seeing the first soldier die. Is there anything else you'd like to say about that?
Well, I remember one of our officers on our staff came into the aid station one time when the big battle in Herlesheim, the Bulge battle for us, and seeing, listening to the screaming, the crying, the wounded, and he was shaking. He said, "Doc, an aid station is a hell of a place to fight a war, isn't it? It's a hell of a place." They suddenly saw the reality of it, which they didn't see any other time. And it's something you can't describe, I guess. You have to be in a war to know what a war is like. You're outside all human dimensions. You're in a world where nothing you ever learned obtains anymore.
Were you in the position then where you needed to triage patients?
All the time, fast. And brutally sometimes. There are one or two doctors for 20 or 30 badly wounded men. So we'd work fast. And our aid men got to be pretty experienced. If someone was going to die, we'd make them comfortable. We'd concentrate on the people we could save. And triage is what we did all the time, you bet.
Did your unit ever take any prisoners?
Many. Started taking prisoners as soon as we got on the line.
How were they treated?
Treated well. I never saw any brutality or ill treatment. When they were first captured up front, and if they were giving somebody a lot of sass or lip, as we always said in my generation, they might get kicked in the rear end to hurry them along with the other prisoners. That's about as far as it ever went. No, they were treated, Geneva Conference, Articles of War, very well indeed. And we took a lot of prisoners.
Was anything ever confiscated from them that you know of?
From prisoners? Gee, I didn't, that I can remember. I don't think people did. We had a prisoner of war interrogation team right with our combat command headquarters. And this was a refugee from Germany, an anti-Nazi German, and he loved interrogating those Germans. So they would threaten him, but they never harmed him, ever. They used psychological threatening and all kinds of gestures with guns and things to make them talk, but nobody was ever hurt.
Did they use you for your German language abilities?
Well, they had a whole team there, but I would just spontaneously pick up things. Prisoners were so happy to be taken alive. And they'd heard so much propaganda about the Jewish-American Roosevelt Bolshevik murderers who were going to torture them and so on. And they found we were nice guys. We gave them, bandaged up their wounds, gave them a shot, maybe something to eat. That they'd talk. I couldn't shut them up. Who their regiment was, where they were coming from, which officer they didn't like, who was a big Nazi, who wasn't, yada-da-da-da. And they found I was not going to hurt them. I was helping them, and I spoke German. I couldn't keep quiet. There was no trouble getting information out of wounded German prisoners.
So you cared for the wounded German?
Oh, exactly like ours. I took care of hundreds and hundreds of wounded Germans.
Did you have any contact at all with any of the civilian German population?
Well, that was after the breakthrough started, yeah. I left off with the Battle of the Bulge, our end of it, the Alsatian Bulge. We liberated the city of Colmar. They stopped the Bulge fighting with time to prepare for our big offensive that ended the war. In February, we were loaned to the French First Army. And three American divisions went south to the great city of Colmar, and we liberated the whole southern Alsace, where to the Swiss border. And we had the nice experience of rolling into a liberated city with people screaming and yelling and waving and handing flowers and bottles of wine through the windows and so on. And it was a savage fight for a while because, again, it was Heinrich Himmler, prestige area with his SS troops. They were fighting the 10th SS Mountain Division. And we met the French Algerian division coming up from the Swiss border, and that was it. The last French soil was cleared. But I had an interesting experience. I wrote in my book, because I speak German, I was involved in picking up the leading Nazi collaborator in Lower Alsace. Do you have time to talk about it?
Absolutely. What was his name?
Okay, Ulmer, as I recall. After the fighting stopped, we set up our command post in a Gasthaus, an inn. And we looked around for the owner. Usually made a deal for the occupation forces. You'll be paid for your this, the yada. Is it all right? Because this is France, after all. Nobody around. And about evening, a little Alsatian peasant came up. He was talking to the guard and the intelligence officer, who didn't speak a word of either French or German. So I went out and talked to him. And he said, "Do you want to pick up the biggest Nazi collaborator in all Alsace? And he said, certainly we do. He said, he's the burgomaster of this town. That's his inn you're in that you took over. So we all picked up Tommy guns and got two Jeeps. And we got the little farmer. The little farmer was so afraid of this man, he didn't want to go with us. The little man with a cap and a half-inch cigarette sticking out of his face. We got him in the Jeeps. We wound down through the streets. We walked up to the door, and in my best German cop method, which I got from reading German detective stories, I knocked at the door, and I said, we found out, they told us, I should say, he's hiding in the house of a Jew that he sent to a concentration camp. Not in his own house, but this guy knew where he was. So I knocked on the door, and a white-haired woman appeared, and I said, Frau Ulmer, yeah. I said, Herr Ulmer, is he? Yes, in said German. I said, bitte kommen Sie mit uns, wir möchten ein paar Fragen. So I guess I'm forgetting, so he came to the door. Now, he looked like Emil Jannings in a 1920-some movie. He had Prussian-style cropped gray hair, kind of heavy, with a watch chain, six chins. And he said, yo. That all comes back to me. He said, yo, Alsace for ja. And I said, Herr Ulmer, yo. And I said, bitte kommen Sie mit uns, wir möchten ein paar Fragen stellen. Please come with us, we'd like to place a few questions. That was the standard thing the SS, the Gestapo used. He knew exactly it. Everyone in this crowd, he had a wife and two grown daughters, and they all started screaming and yelling and waving and so on. And we walked in. I remember I was carrying a Tommy gun. And about it was too cold. We couldn't take our poor old father out in the cold, and he catched pneumonia. And I said, no, we're going to bundle him up very warmly. This one was quite a painful scene. Finally, he got a fedora hat and a scarf, and we took him off. And I remember, I'm an American after all. I'm not used to being a Gestapo type, and I was feeling sorry for the family. So we got him down into the Jeep, and there's some soldiers down there working on some wine they'd liberated from our infantry battalion. And one of them said, who's the old guy, Doc? And I said, he's the biggest Nazi collaborator around here. We're going to turn him over to the French. The daughter turned to him, one of the grown-ups who spoke pretty good English. She said, please, please. And the soldier said, oh, lady, don't worry. All they're going to do is shoot the old son of a bitch. And I said, oh, God, get us out of here. So we got the Jeep and took off. And we held him overnight. And we got a radio from the French First Army when they heard we had him. And they sent a young officer down in an old French Army blue overcoat the next day to pick him up. And our colonel said, now tell us what he did. Well, he sent rounded up the Jews of the town, sent them to concentration camps to be killed. He did this. He tortured the resistance people. He was an out-and-out Nazi. And he said the last thing he did, he got hostages. Just picked up, rounded up innocent people as hostages for something the underground had done. Sent them out in the valley of the Vosges and let them freeze to death slowly under German machine guns. And he said that was the last thing this monster did. And I remember that as we drove into Colmar, one of the first things we saw, the French were with us, the French First Army. There was a big line of Senegalese riflemen, 8 or 10 or 11 of them, facing a wall. Suddenly realized it was a firing squad. They were shooting collaborators. So the French didn't take very long to administer justice. And in the course of taking care of the wounded in the town, a sister, a nun, came to our aid station. So I said, fine, we'll take care of the wounded. And we drove around with the nun, Schwester Rose. And there's one little old grandmother had a compound fracture of the femur. The bones were sticking out through the skin. She'd been there for 2 days. We splinted it, put traction splints, did the things you do. We hauled her down in a litter down the winding stairs. And she got off some line about, I better not talk to the handsome major anymore. He's going to drop me or something. She sounds so funny. I said, gee, you remind me of some Jewish grandmothers I knew in the Bronx. She got terrified. She said, how'd you know? Vyatskivus. And she says, yeah, she was Jewish, all right. She's the only one left. She said, she's been alive. The Andrea said, Aleto, everyone else is dead. I'm the only one, an Alta Hexa. She's an old witch like me. I'm still alive. So I said, Grandma, Großmutti, Yiddish is good. Jewish is good. Jewish is heroic. Jewish gets you a medal. And we took her into the big city hospital in Colmar, about 10 miles away, and delivered her over to the French doctors and got them taken care of. And she said, don't tell him. She was still so afraid, because the Vichy French were as anti-Semitic as the Germans. She kept saying, nein, geheim. I said, geheim. I remember the young French doctor, they're all bilingual Alsatians. He said, gee, you speak good German. I said, yeah, I learned it in school. And he said, you two got a big secret. Yeah, big secret. We'll never, she didn't want them to know she was Jewish.
How did she manage to conceal her identity?
Oh, yeah. Well, from them anyway. And she'd hidden out in this house. She was the last Jew in Herrlesheim-Prey-Colmar. The others were all killed. The little lady.
So where did you go from Colmar? What happened next?
Oh, then we went to reserve. Pick up tanks, replace infantry casualties, of course. And we were in reserve for a couple of weeks, and then we went on a night march up through Luxembourg to 3rd Army. 3rd Army was Patton, the much-advertised Patton's army on our left flank. We were the veterans of the 7th Army. But what had happened was the Saar-Moselle Triangle flows into the Rhine. Yeah, the Rhine makes kind of a loop, a curve toward the west. It starts in Switzerland, flows north, and then turns northwest. And the Moselle flows into it. And so there's a big trapezoid formed from the south. That's called the Saar Basin, a big industrial area. And the Germans had their Siegfried Line forts all along the front of it, which we've been battering against. But the 3rd Army on our left had broken through the Siegfried Line and was all the way up the Moselle to the Rhine. So the flank was open. So they loaned our division to 3rd Army. We made a long night march through Luxembourg, up the Moselle, through the burning city of Trier, and over the pontoon bridge into Germany. And then we were in this wild cavalry shoot 'em up campaign that lasted about 10 days in the rear. 3 armored divisions of breath, we slammed into the rear of a whole German army group who were facing south, and they looked over their shoulders, and here we came. So mad. At one point, we didn't sleep for 3 days and 3 nights once, I remember. You'd be running through German artillery from the rear with horses galloping through the flames. And we finally met the 7th Army coming up at the city of Speyer on the Rhine. We were the lead division in the whole 3rd Army attack in the Saar Basin. We led the way to the Rhine. And because we weren't 3rd Army, Georgie Patton wouldn't release our division identity. So the newspapers knew perfectly well who we were. The correspondent, they called us the Mystery Division. I thought that Mystery Division leads Patton's army to the Rhine. That was us. And then we rested there a little bit, went back to the 7th Army, crossed under smoke screen in the dead of night, crossed the Rhine at Mannheim, and attacked straight east into the Odenwald, the mountains that are a continuation north of the Schwarzwald, the Black Forest. And then we really went. The U.S. Army official histories described the 12th Army. They said they went through the tangles of the Odenwald and went like a bobcat through like a scalded cat through a thicket. We really moved, little task forces. That's when I had lots to do with Germans. I met them everywhere. I talked to them everywhere, of course.
What were some of your experiences with
well,
that?
Well, first was the nonsense, all the walls, all the defiance we saw. You know, Nazi slogans and graffiti on all the walls. But then they all gave up. We call it being snowblind. As we roll into a town, it'd be fluttering with bed sheets, pillowcases, handkerchiefs, anything white they could get out would be fluttering out the window. They gave up fast. The first thing we learned. The second thing we learned is, of course, we were advanced. We'd go through fast. The infantry might take a day or two to catch up with us, so there's a gap in there. And what the Germans themselves were terrified of was their own SS, because they'd come out of the woods and kill any Germans that hung out a white flag if the Americans had gone on ahead or they'd left a little vacuum in the rear. And the Germans would say to me, "Ach, Herr Major, the SS, das sind keine Leute mehr." The SS, they're not human anymore. They were terrified of themselves, that the SS were criminals, no question about it. And the German civilians were as afraid of as anybody else was, I suppose. I remember in the city of Speyer on the Rhine, helping a crowd of German civilians huddled across the street. We had an aid station and a Gasthaus, an inn, and we were running ambulances up and down. It was very heavy fighting. One young German soldier had a leg badly torn up, and steps, so I took his arm, got him over my shoulder, and helped him, carried him down the steps, and all the Germans were astounded. They go, look, he's helping a German, he's helping a German. They couldn't believe that we took such good care of them. But then discovered that several things, how two-faced they were. We go through these towns, and I had an old cross-country ambulance right in the middle of tanks, and I'd be the first Red Cross. And so our prisoners who had been captured by the Germans and marched hard, starved, 25 miles a day, we'd pick them up, liberate them ourselves. And I had the interesting experience of going through a little town. All the Germans were waving and acting like the Lederhosen Bavarian are, how happy we are, and, you know, waving white flags. And the prisoner who was sitting with me in the ambulance said, "Ha, they marched us through here a few days ago. He said, let's get out and I'll show you some guys. He said, I recognize these people. He said, that guy threw me a rock in my face. That guy hit us with a bucket of horse manure. That guy hit us with a shovel. They were screaming, and, you know, for Ricky to even curse the Jews, Heil Hitler, all the rest of it. And then we came and they were 180 degrees. So I remember I terrified this particular bunch. I got out a medical tag, emergency medical tag packet that we put on the wounded. It looked like something official. I went along saying, Vihaistu, what's your name? Vowonsi. And I pretended I was taking down names and addresses. They were terrified. They thought the American had an SS too. But the joke among the Allied forces of the Nazis all evaporated as soon as we crossed the Rhine. Me a Nazi? Never. No. What made you think? No. There's just a few fanatics. All us Germans were just kindly, nice people. And the most hypocritical bunch of people I've ever seen in my life. They swore they'd never had anything to do with the Nazis. And, you know, Germany was 99% Nazi.
During this time, did you have any correspondence with anybody from home?
Oh, wrote home to my wife all the time, my father, my kid brother. We got emails, sure, back and forth.
Were you able to write about everything that was going on? Or?
Pretty much. They didn't. I knew what not to write about. We were supposed to have our mail censored. But censoring mail for a couple million people is almost an impossible job. Officers' mail wasn't censored very much. We could tell them what was happening. Yeah.
At this point, did you know now about concentration camps?
No, we knew just that there was... I'm trying to remember if we'd heard some of the first reports. Not really. We knew there were German camps that were very bad news, where they were very cruel to people. Yes, that much we were sure of. We hadn't heard any, as I recall, by the time we saw the first concentration camp at Lundsberg, we knew it was that they're brutal, that they're bad, but not how bad, we did not quite understand.
Did you have a chance at all to read any, you know, military publications while you were there? And was there anything mentioned in these publications?
Not really,
about?
Not anything I ever saw.
So now where did you go next?
Well, we crossed the Rhine. We kept going to Würzburg. We were way behind the German lines. We were so far behind the German lines one night, I could look back and see the gun flashes on the main front behind us like sheet lightning in the distance. That was the same night that our own artillery blew the radiator out of my ambulance. And by mistake, they were shelling us, and we just went on to Germany to get away from them. But we went on, helped our division take Würzburg, and fought around the Main River near Würzburg. And we were heading straight east. There was nothing stopping us. We were heading for Czechoslovakia. But then Eisenhower's headquarters was worried about a possible last-ditch mountain redoubt in the Bavarian Alps. They thought the Nazis were going to hold it. It was a fairy tale. They weren't, but they thought they were. So instead of going on and liberating Prague, we swung back west, took Ansbach, Germany, and then started south toward the Danube. And all this time, you must picture mobs of German prisoners, mobs of slave workers liberate in every town. You see, the Germans use slaves, don't forget. They reintroduced human slavery into Europe on a large scale.
Who were the slaves?
Poles, Czechs, political prisoners, French, Italians, anybody from any country. They just picked them up by truckloads. Greek, all the countries of the Balkans, they pick up young men, put them in trucks, or any age men and women, and use them for slave labor in Germany. The first thing we saw when we crossed the border in the Saar Basin operation, as I recall, was Yugoslavs. They just trucked them off like human cattle and used them as slaves. The farms workers were all non-German slave workers. The factories were staffed with slave workers. And, of course, they came out yelling and screaming hysterically when they saw us coming in. And then, they'd turn and start looting the German warehouses, and the Germans would come to us with great indignation. How can you allow this to happen? We said, you brought them here, fellas. It's your problem, you know. You've been starving them for years. So the rioting went on in all the towns as we went through. Half the population of Europe had been enslaved by the Germans, I suppose.
And so you continued?
Yeah, we kept going south.
South.
And we came to the first concentration camp was on the Lech River near Lundsberg, Germany.
But when is this?
I have to look at the date. It's on my division, right? It's in April.
Of what year?
45.
And what was the name of this camp?
Landsberg. The only name that was not the name of the city there, Landsberg, Germany. Middle-sized city where Adolf Hitler had been held as a prisoner in the fortress after his putsch of 1922 or 3, whenever that was. Token imprisonment.
What do you remember about the very first thing that you saw upon entrance to the camp?
A very good young assault gun commander named Lieberman, a Jewish boy from New York, getting sick in my aid station because he went first. I was busy with a bunch of wounded or organizing ambulances or something, and he said, there's one of those goddamn camps up there, somebody said, and he drove up, and he came back white as a sheet and threw up. I gave him some morphine and brandy, and kind of, he was almost hysterical. And this is a brave man who'd been through a lot of fighting, been battlefield promoted from a sergeant to a lieutenant. So the signal officer and I, my friend Sobrowski, loaded a jeep with loaves of bread from the kitchen truck, from the mess truck, and drove up toward this camp. It was in the morning, a gray, cloudy morning. I'll never forget this. And we're driving through these pine woods in northern Bavaria. And the road was kind of muddy, half mud, half rain. And we started seeing bodies lying by the road. And I naturally, they were just all any old place by the road. And they're obviously going to get run over or something. Got out to just lift one up, move it off to the side of the road. It seemed kind of obscene to let dead bodies lay around, and I couldn't believe it. He had one of these blue and striped, white striped outfits on, prison outfits, face down in the mud. And I turned on, I remember lifting the body, it was like a child's body. It was, so, it was a man, a full-grown man, but I don't suppose he weighed 50 or 60 pounds. And that face came up out of the mud with the mud dribbling off it, and I can see it as if it were yesterday. Your eyes, you know, have fat around them, so that when you get hit with something, you don't, it's a cushion of fat. The fat was gone, and the eyes were just in this bone sockets, huge, like the eyes of a bird. His face was thin like a razor, the nose was thin like a razor, and the face was just like a skull with brown paint on it. And it's just, the lips were peeled back from the teeth, with a snarl like that from starvation. It looked like a scream. It's just a sign. I remember thinking, that man's screaming, but I can't hear it. I lifted him up and put him aside. As we went along, we kept moving the bodies off. Later, we found out what had happened when our scout cars, which are the advance of an armored division, Scott had come up. These men were crawling out through the mud on their hands and knees, kissing the gas cans on our scout cars, and fell dead. At least they knew they'd been liberated, whatever good that did them. So we came around the corner, and then we heard a few shots. And we thought, uh-oh, our Bronk took down his carbine, because there are always SS snipers hiding in the woods and things. And we came around the corner, and there was the camp, big barbed wire, and there's a mob of people, and an American officer standing there shooting his pistol in the air. And the people were, it looked bizarre, they're falling, they're lying, they're hanging on to each other, they're so weak that some could stand, some were lying in the mud. It kind of resolved itself as we came up this inchoate form into a lot of people. And they saw us come in with that jeep full of loaves of bread. Well, it turned out the officer was from the American Allied military government. And his idea was getting their attention by shooting his pistol in the air while he tried to get their names and addresses on a piece of paper on a clipboard, which is about the mentality of the Allied military government at that stage. Of all the useless procedures I can imagine, that was the last one, but there he was. And they were trying to cooperate, poor people, because he was an American, and they loved him. And they were falling in the muds, and he's saying, what's your name? Where do you live? But they saw that food, and they forget the military government. They came for us, hundreds of them. And those old army jeeps were kind of low to the ground. And I remember looking up at this gray April sky, and it just disappeared in a forest of claws. I mean, claws, like a Hitchcock movie coming at you. And they could not control themselves. I remember thinking, they can't, it's like a stone falling, they can't help themselves. And the screaming was very high-pitched quality, like seabirds. Later, it's from the starvation. The nasal tissues were wasted, the pharynxes were wasted, and it came out with a high-pitched, nasal screams. And I thought, oh my God, these people are out of control. They'll tear us to pieces. But nothing we can do. The spooky thing, a sensation I can remember as I sit here this afternoon, they clutched, and the hardest clutch of hundreds of these people, the hardest frenzied clutch they could make felt like feathers brushing your face. like cotton wool, I remember thinking. It was ghostly, like a bunch of ghosts running their hands over you. And they were clutching as hard as they could clutch. They could not stop themselves when they saw that food. This went on. Well, there's a little Russian boy, a teenager, who was not as starved as the rest. And he helped us get things kind of organized. But it was hard. The poor people could not control themselves. So we kept tearing the loaves of bread in half and giving one to each person. They kept cramming it in their mouths, crying and crying. It took a long time to get things in some kind of, but they were used to standing in lines and order and so on. So we saw that everybody got some bread in that particular, until ours was used up. And then I was standing talking to some of them. They all spoke some German. And even though they were Poles and Russians and everything else, they spoke enough German to get along by that time. And talking to this one young Jew, and he kept talking to me between mouthfuls of bread, and he kept stroking me, saying, "Freunde, Freunde, Freunde, friends, friends, friends." He couldn't believe we were friends. And then he kept saying, "Mutti, Vati, Bruder, Schwester, alle verbrannt, verbrannt, verbrannt. Mother, fathers, brothers, sisters, all burned, burned, burned." And then he tried to cry. These people had no tear ducts. They couldn't make tears. And his chest would heave, these great sobs. "Mutti, Vati, Bruder, verbrannt, 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 burned, burned." It's all he could get out. Well, we went on through the rest of the camp and took the pictures that I'll show you later. And I was almost out of film, but I was lucky because the signal officer had lots of film, of course, and he had a Sergeant Lieberman from New York, Liebschitz. I'll take his name, Liebschitz. He was with us. They took some great pictures. That's how we pooled pictures later on. We walked through the camp, and there were just dead bodies, as you'll see, that you had to, it was hard not to step on them. There were so many dead bodies lying around the ground. They were just thick.
Was there an odor?
Oh, God, yes.
How would you describe it?
Well, the first odor, it's an odor we knew pretty well, and that is when something is burned and rained on. The first time you shell a town and move in, a lot of carcass, dead people and dead animals, and they get burned and rained on. That was the old battlefield smell, the smell of something burned and dead and rained on, dead flesh. And we walked through the camp. We were puzzled at first. We saw these remnants of the A-frame huts. They had A-frame huts that were about 6 feet high, earth floor. And there were bodies piled up. A lot of them were burned or charred. And some places there was just a frame of the hut left, nothing left. And wherever these burned huts had been, there were piles of blackened bodies, contorted. And we found out what had happened from the scene that a detachment of German engineers from the TOT organization, T-O-D-T, the TOT group. That's the German word for death, appropriately, but there's a man named TOT who was the head of the engineer group. Had been told them to kill as many as they could before the Americans liberated the place. Why, God knows. I mean, it wasn't the excuse you hear from the Holocaust deniers is that they had to burn people for sanitary reasons or something, but there was no sanitation. There was no anything. They could hear the American tank guns down the road, the American machine guns, and they went on an orgy of killing. They couldn't serve their purpose or any other purpose except killing for the sake of killing. So they locked these people up in these A-frame huts, and they threw gasoline on, and they set fire to it, and they burned them. They just roasted them alive in these huts. And that's the bodies that we're seeing, which you'll see the pictures of. And the guards had stood around with bayonets, and of course the ground was wet. These poor people were frenzied in their attempt to crawl out. And some of them dug their way out, and they just pinned them to the ground with bayonets through the neck or through the heart. So, and what purpose they thought they were serving, God only knows. But this is all over the camp. So they killed a lot of people. Out of 8,000 people, I think they killed all except three.
We have to stop this tape now. We'll continue with the next day.
Let me get up and cough.
is January 19th, 1997. Dr. Phibbs, we left off on the last tape. We were talking about the liberation of Landsberg.
Right.
And the bodies that you came upon that had been
burned alive. There were many, of course, who had died of starvation in the camp, who had been just allowed to lie around. They had no time to dispose of them. But the ones who had been burned, you could see that they died in agony, as you'll see in the pictures that we're going to show. The arms were upflung. They were screaming and dying. We didn't have the exact numbers, but somebody figured that of the 8,000 inhabitants, a small camp, designated Jews political prisoners, by the way, of the 8,000, all but 3,000 had been killed, shot, and burned to death. And this, I emphasize, was done in a totally senseless manner. It couldn't accomplish anything even in their own perverted ends. It was just killing to kill. They didn't want these people to be liberated. They didn't want the victory to be the inmates. And they wanted a final victory of a perverted savage guy, so they just killed most of them. Our division, the whole division caught up. Our division headquarters people, the military government, rallied around. They opened a hospital for them and took over buildings and rallied medical support for those who were still alive. The big concern, of course, was about typhus, which was untreatable in those days. And we only stayed 2 days because we were combat elements. We went right on. But they got the mayor and a bunch of German civilians out from town, marched them out, made them look at the whole thing, and made them dig graves, mass graves for the dead. And they had a burial service. Of course, nobody knew who these people were or had the vaguest notion of what their religion was. So they had a rabbi, a Protestant chaplain, and a priest each read their respective services, and we buried the dead. And, of course, the usual, we have pictures of the German civilians carrying the dead. And the thing to notice is that the German civilians were fat, muscular, well-fed, with no signs of any malnutrition. The standard excuse for the camps, of course, by those who would deny them is that everybody was on short rations, not the German civilians. They were the best-fed people in Europe because they'd looted all of Europe. And the contrast in the pictures is all too plain.
What was their reaction to seeing these bodies? Well,
they were pretty horrified. They knew it was bad, but I don't think they were prepared for just how bad it was. Some of them got sick. Some of them got hysterical. And they kept standards, nie gemütet, we never suspected, Over and over again, they kept saying it. We didn't suspect it, we didn't believe it, we didn't know what was going on. And the other thing is, the standard line you heard from the Germans, what could we do about it? We were under kleine Leute, we were only little people, what could we do? So, and of course, the standard line was, of course, you understand, Major, I was never a Nazi, not me. And you heard that from everybody all the time. Those are the three, real horror, though, and real disgust, disbelief. That was genuine.
When you entered the camp, were there any Nazi or German guards left
there? Oh, they
were
gone. They'd run away. When the American machine guns got anywhere near, they took to their heels and left their victims behind. They were not only murderers, but cowards.
So none of them were caught?
Not of that group. We got the story from the other prisoners of what had happened.
There were men and women in Landsberg, prisoners?
Yeah, sure. Totally mixed.
Were there any children?
I didn't see any in that particular camp.
The survivors that you met, can you describe their physical condition?
Well, they were the same as the people I saw in Dachau. They're unlike anything I've seen in 50 years as a physician. I have seen people die of about every disease you can think of. And I've seen every kind of starvation and malnutrition as a result of disease primarily. But I've never seen anything like these people. Again, they were so thin that the faces looked like birds' faces, you know, the bones projected. The arms were just bones, barely covered. The knees, the joints were protuberant. The leg would be tiny and thin, and then there'd be a great big ball socket of a joint, and then a tiny, thin little rail of bone going on up above it. And I couldn't understand quite how they even stood, the poor people, or how they could move, but they could do it. I didn't have time for a lot of examination at Landsberg, but I did at Dachau, because we were the combat elements, and on we went. But our division rear people did a pretty good, creditable job of cleaning it up and getting the dead buried and the living into hospitals and getting food to everybody.
Did you remember communicating with any one particular survivor, any incident that you can recall at Lonsberg?
The young Jewish boy that I met first is the only one I remember vividly out of a sea of faces. The one who told me his mother and father both had been burned, burned, burned. And he's the one that sticks in my mind, standing there clutching that what was left of that loaf of bread, chewing on it and crying as hard as he could cry. Terrible sight.
Were there any crematoria, gas chambers?
No. This was a simple work and death camp. They were put there to be starved and worked to death is what they really were. And the killing was incidental. In other words, they saw the Allies approaching and the orders were kill them all. That's the kind of camp it was.
Any animal pens that you noticed at all?
Pardon?
Animal pens at all in this camp? Animal stalls of any kind?
No, nothing like that. Again, we were there briefly. As I said, I had to go back and arrange for the attack the next morning, the day after that.
Was there any sort of hospital facility?
Not for the prisoners. I guess they had a little dispensary or something, but it was so crude you wouldn't want to use it. Our people just took over a German building in the town and turned it into a hospital.
Do you know who the commandant of the camp was?
Never did find out who was responsible for all this. I have a feeling the military government people may have discovered it, or the people who were doing the denazification studied later in Germany.
And were you aware of any of the prisoners, any acts of retaliation on the prisoners' parts towards any of them? Did any of them go after the guards or try to find them? Or
The guards took their heels so fast, there was no question of catching this particular group. They were gone.
What happened after you left
Lonsberg? Well, after that, we attacked south, and our division seized the first bridge over the Danube, intact. You know, the Danube runs east and west there. And as you came south, suddenly there were the Bavarian Alps. Just came around the corner one day, and there the sky was full of mountains. And we thought, oh, God, we have to fight our way through those. Because the thought was the Germans were dug into the Bavarian Alps, which they weren't. So they... At a division commander's, battalion commander's meeting that morning, someone tried some clumsy humor. The commanding general said, "Gentlemen, there's a river 40 miles south of here, and I hear that it's blue. Go check it out." He meant the beautiful blue Danube, of course. So, and that backfired on us. So we took off and streamed toward the Danube, three columns. And with CCB on the left, CR on the right, CCA in the middle. And it had a bridge that we were going to try and get intact before the Germans could blow it up. And an odd thing happened as we went streaming south. We suddenly heard the radio started to chatter from CCR, Combat Command Reserve. We got a bridge over the Danube. Holy cow. You know, intact, seizing it, like the bridge they seized at the Rhine a couple of months before. And in fact, they had. The Task Force Ippolito, under a little Italian New York kid named Ippolito, went into the town with the guns blazing and shot up everything. The German dived in their hole. They ran across the bridge, they got the demolitions, which were big airplane bombs, wired to go up, and they cut the wires before they could explode them, and threw them in the Danube, and we had a bridge over the Danube. Well, the odd thing was, got into the Army histories, then the radio said, "Hey, the bridge is blown." We were just a couple of, when a bridge goes up, you see it, and it was clear, from a long way off. We said, "It didn't blow." And all the confusion went back, the bridge over the Danube went all the way to Army headquarters, 7th Army, they had a bridge, but it got blown. It's all in the history books. And then it turned out, no, it wasn't. Ippolito remembered what he heard that morning at the briefing. He said, "We got a bridge over the river, and it's blue." This was turned into blown. So anyway, we pulled up for the night at the picture I've shown you at the castle at Hochstadt, which is a 1,000-year-old castle that Napoleon had used for headquarters. And I went riding out with the tanks while we shot up some Germans who were trying to lay minefields on the other side against our crossing. We crossed over and did some heavy fighting for 2 days south of the Danube and then broke out toward the Alps. And suddenly we came over a hill and I could see German prisoners as far as you could see them. Thousands and thousands and thousands. The whole German army marching in, demoralized, beaten, weaponless, hands up, marching by. I couldn't believe how many Germans I saw marching to the rear. And we pushed south toward the Danube, beyond the Danube to the Alps. And our last goal was the next valley over from Oberammergau, the famous place where the Passion Play is put on every year. And there we were in the middle of the towering snow peaks. And that was our last position. We were ordered to hold in place. one of our combat commands of our division went racing on, and they liberated a fort where they were holding many distinguished prisoners, the Premier of France and many other people whom they had not quite killed yet. And they got into the castle, and the SS troops who were behind them attacked them. And the odd thing was a German officer fought the SS troops to help them try and save the prisoners. There were some decent Germans. And he was killed in the fighting, but then our column came up, drove the SS off, and they saved the Premier of France, Daladier, and a bunch of other distinguished people. Another team at that point in the war said they found some crazy kraut scientists hiding in a cave talking about a wind tunnel or something. It was one of Wernher von Braun's rocket teams. They were running away from the Russians. And we picked them up. Top priority. The Allies wanted them. So we picked up Wernher von Braun. And part of our division captured von Rundstedt, the famous German general who commanded the Battle of the Bulge. Marched him in. So we were picking up big game at the end of the war.
Did you get to personally?
I didn't see Rundstedt. He was too far. I wanted to go give him a hard time, but I didn't get to get. They'd marched him back when I got over there. So the war ended there, and we sat in place.
This was when now? What
May. We stopped advancing about May 4th. There was no more resistance. We were told to hold in place. The Germans and Southeast Army Front surrendered a day or two ahead of the regular surrender. And we worked with some veterans of the Yugoslav Regular Army who'd been prisoners of war. It was slave laborers, and gave them guns. They the only prisoners we ever liberated, they went out in the mountains hunting up the SS troops, and they loved it. They'd flush them out and bring them in terrified with their hands over their heads. They're tough people, Yugoslavs. So we, then on May 7th, the big surrender was signed. But before that, we pulled back. We met the 5th Army coming up from Italy. The war was over as far as we were concerned. They pulled us back north of the Danube. And we're sitting in a town called Wasseralfing in northern Bavaria. And the news came over the radio that the surrender at Reims. The Dönitz, the German admiral, had surrendered. No underground, no werewolves, no resistance. It's all over. And I walked into the command post with a colonel. The 3 battalion commanders were playing roadblocks and operations. And I said, gentlemen, by the way, the war just ended. And they looked at it and said, oh, yeah, thanks, Doc, okay. It went right on. They couldn't stop what they were doing. Finally, that night we celebrated. But we were up at a city called Dillingen on the Danube where we got in the bridge. Shuffled around a couple of days after the surrender. And a young Captain Levy, Matt Levy from New York on there, stopped in to have lunch at our officer's mess. When you traveled, you stopped in at other officers' messes for lunch or something. And he told me he was working in Dachau in the typhus center. He described the conditions there. And the food problems they were having, things like that. So I thought, golly, I ought to help out. I had no more wound to take care of. I had nothing to do in my official capacity. We had plenty of medical personnel for the kids that got sick or something. So with the consent of my commanding officer, I took my ambulance and drove through Augsburg and down to Dachau, the 66th Field Hospital, which is the typhus center. Introduced myself to the colonel, commanding officer. He said, fine, Major, always glad to have extra hands. Welcome aboard. So I got sprayed with DDT to kill lice, of course, and went to work in the typhus hospital, stayed in the barracks there. I spent 2 weeks in Dachau in the typhus center. You want me to tell about that?
Yes, we do.
Well, of course, typhus is the disease that's transmitted by the bite of a louse, and it's a rickettsial disease, a germ that's the littlest thing you can see with an ordinary microscope. Bigger than a virus, smaller than the bacteria. It causes Rocky Mountain spotted fever. It causes many different kinds of disease. In those days, there was no treatment. Nowadays, you can take mycin, any of the mycins, and you're well in 48 hours. In those days, it was usually half the time fatal. So the prisoners were lousy. The filthy condition in these camps, they had lice. And typhus broke out everywhere. So the field hospital was set up in a great big barracks, one of those big things with the sign that said, Arbeit macht frei, work will make you free, the nastiest joke ever pulled on a bunch of unfortunate people. And there are beds, I guess there were 40 in a row, like a big gymnasium there in cots, lying there. And they had set up, this is a real field hospital, rear installation. They had nurses, medical personnel, proper intravenous equipment, things like that. And excuse me, I'm getting caught in this wire here. There. So these people, what they all looked like the people at the living I'd seen at Lundsberg. Again, they were skeletons, just skeletons. And speaking as a medical man, I was curious. I'd ask them if they could. I'd take, put my arms, fingers around the arm. You could put your fingers around a man's upper arm, just like that. And I'd say, bit it, rear and see your bind, move your arm. And they could move it, but I couldn't feel any muscle. I didn't know what they moved it with. All I felt was bone there, starved beyond belief. Many of them had tuberculosis, of course. They had starvation. They had a condition called beriberi heart, which is what you get from a lack of thiamine, vitamin B1. The heart gets huge and then goes into failure. So on the little x-ray machine, we had these huge hearts that half fill the chest. So they were starved. They had beriberi. They had tuberculosis, and then they got typhus. So they died like flies. We could give them intravenous fluids. We could give them drugs like digitalis to strengthen the heart. We could give them adrenaline when the blood pressure fell too low. But that was about all we could do. What we could do was very limited, and feed them. Feeding them was the big thing. That made the enormous difference. As soon as they could get some food in, some of them got better. And people who were in Dachau were every race you can think of. I didn't see any black people, but I saw everybody else you could possibly think of. Every country in Europe, every country in the Western world. There were some Americans in Dachau, but I didn't see any of them in other parts of the camp. And they told me story after story of the kind I'm sure you've heard over and over again, being picked up for their race, half of them, or religion, in some cases, or political beliefs. One of the people I visited with most was the Dutch physician who'd been a member of the Dutch Communist Party. Of course, he got snapped up early on, and he was staggering and almost falling down. But he insisted on sitting up with us, reading x-rays, and filling his role as a physician once again. It was very wonderful to see. I hope he lived. But as we walked down the aisle, along the Isle of Beds, our chief helper was a young Yugoslav surgeon who was a prisoner himself. But he hadn't been in long enough to be starved very much. So he had an American Army uniform. We called him Tito Minor, which made him very proud. And he's a graduate of the University of Belgrade. And he knew about typhus because he was part of the partisan army, the guerrillas. Of course, they were lousy, and he knew typhus when he saw it. The Americans didn't know typhus. They'd never seen a case. So he would go along, and with typhus you get spots. The blood vessels rupture, and they leave spots on the skin. Fleck typhus is called, spotted typhus. And he could call the shots better than any of us. He'd say, "Gibt's mehr Fleck, the Zunge ist trocken, heute Abend tot." The more spots, the tongue is dry, you'll be dead tonight. And they were. The way typhus works is that the germ attacks the tiny blood vessels called capillaries, the littlest ones that you rupture when you have a nosebleed, and any part of your body. If it attacks it in the gastrointestinal tract, you vomit blood and you pass blood in the stool and you die. If it's in the lungs, you cough blood and hemorrhage in your lung and die. We saw both types. The people's lungs would just fill up with blood, and there wasn't anything we could do about it except keep them comfortable. The gastrointestinal type was particularly horrible to take care of, as you can imagine. Blood coming out both ends. And sometimes it attacks the central nervous system. I wrote about that in my book, the spinal cord and brain. And this one pathetic case I can remember to my dying day. This man had typhus of the spinal cord and brain, and he was convulsing like a man with lockjaw. And he drew himself up in a bow so that just his heels and the back of his head touched the bed. The rest of his body was just taut like that, screaming at the top of his lungs. Then he fell dead, whang, just while we looked at him. The death rate was so high that we always knew as we went along each row of beds, which was, say, 40-some, as I recall, someone would be dead, that we'd pass, that had been alive when we went by. It was incredibly high. The stories, of course, were endless. I was picked up because I was Jew. It was very common. And I've worked here and worked there. And the secondhand stories I heard of the beatings and shootings and the casual murders were blood-curdling, and I guess you've heard plenty of stories like that.
Do you recall any one particular incident with any typhus patient, any contact that you had personally?
Well, one man told me about being in one of those railway boxcars. When they lock, you know, they slam people in a boxcar so tightly they couldn't breathe, no sanitation, no water or anything, and he was one of what, half a dozen people that lived when they opened the doors and the dead bodies fell out. And that was a one man, many of them had been in the transport trains, and they all had pretty much the same story. They were the 10% that survived that little process. And then they would talk about certain guards, furchtbar, they say, furchtbar, frightful, frightful, who would be just sadists and were allowed to take out their sadism on prisoners. Some of the, they made a big distinction between a guard that was not too bad and the guard that was horrible. The guys that just carried out orders and the ones that went way beyond, they just kill people. And I heard many, many, they tell you, those have been in a camp together someplace. You know, they moved them around the different camps for various reasons. I never understood why. Say, oh, so at Auschwitz or something, oh, Furchtbar, Furchtbar, a particular guard. Many of the guards that were the worst, according to the prison, were Ukrainians, by the way, which is a fact not sufficiently appreciated today. The you mentioned Ukrainer, and they all start swearing and cursing. They'd all had terrible treatment from Ukrainian guards who worked for the Germans. Apparently, anti-Semitism is a way of life in the Ukraine for a lot of people. And they were unanimous in saying that if possible, is it possible to be worse than a German? They'd say, yeah, Ukraine is worse. And, of course, starvation continued to be a problem on the limited rations we could get for them until we finally got enough food, thank God, and some of them started to get better.
What food were they given?
Army rations. There was a lot of administrative confusion at first. The first thing they did was just get C rations, K, the stuff we ate, which is pretty awful. Combat troops, C rations, K rations, 10 and 1, put them in a big stew pot, mix it up, and feed them out of it. Then the regulations, they found regulations, well, you can't use army rations, they yada, 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 and they were trying to get the German civilians to bring in food. I could have told them that was a waste of time. But they finally had a big captured enemy warehouse in Munich. They were able to get food from that. So before I left, the food situation had straightened itself out pretty well. And there, I remember one prisoner who was not one of the most starved, we had all degrees, you know. Said, Merelskenogmeyer, I had more than enough to eat today. He said, I never thought I'd see the day when I'd say I had more than enough to eat, but I had more than enough to eat. That felt good.
How many prisoners would you say there were when you came to Dachau, the typhus unit? How many people were there, approximately?
Well, I'm mentally kind of maybe 1,000 in the typhus ward, and they kept coming in every day and dying. I would guess somewhere, it would fluctuate from a 500 to 1,000. It's a big building. I just remember these long, long rows of cots. I would guess from 500 to 1,000 most of the time.
And those patients that died, where were their bodies to
taken? You know, I was never sure of that. There was some machinery for taking care of them. Their bodies were taken away. And what was done about notifying kin if they could find them or burying them or what, I really don't know. And that we were so concerned with trying to save the living that we just knew that when people died, they were whisked off someplace. And I had not, until you asked me that question, I hadn't thought about that. But the it was a bewildering variety of backgrounds when you talk to these people. And they all spoke some German. And since I speak fluent German, I did a lot of interpreting. A Pole would talk to a Czech, would talk to a this, would talk to me, and we'd go back down the chain so they could all communicate with each other.
So how did some of these people recover? You said there really was no treatment for it. What made some recover?
Because like most infections except AIDS and rabies, a certain number of people will always recover. The immune body, even under those conditions, and especially the ones that hadn't been starved that long. You see, you had all degrees of starvation. Some people had only been there a month, and they were pretty thin, but they weren't terminally starved, and they had a much better chance of living.
Did you get to see any of the other buildings in Dachau while you were there, any other facilities that were there?
Not really. They didn't want us running around the camp because we were in the typhus center. And even though we had typhus shots and we put DDDDD, there was the idea, stay where you are. Don't go around and look at the rest of the building. I've seen pictures of the gas chambers and the crematoria.
But you didn't actually see it?
I didn't actually see them myself. We were not encouraged to wander around when we were in the typhus center.
Did anything else happen while you were there that you care to recall?
Oh, I'm trying to think now. There's so many stories I heard from these people, you know. Well, I can remember a sense of hope. that I heard among these people. And they were, it's hard to believe that they were talking about what's the best political system for Europe and the world. I mean, they were thinking, even in the middle of this horror, the social democrats are not a good idea. We need the this, we need the that. And they get into political arguments. Liana, don't let Alex in. The big Russian kid is coming. Go ahead. Sorry. Visitors at the door.
So you were saying that there was a sense of hope amongst
some of what amazed me was that someone said, well, we have figured we'd die, but we're sure some of us would live. We're sure you guys would get here someday. And that was a very moving thing to hear. And they had even, when they had bits of paper or something to write on, they were writing notes on things as remote as philosophy and government and on and on and on. It was very moving to see the courage of these people, the survivors. And they were, what does a guy do with this kind of government? Would you run for office in politics and so on? How would you prevent things like the Nazis from happening again? That's what I went away with, this amazing sense of courage that you saw in the survivors when I finally left Dachau.
How long did you remain at Dachau?
2 weeks. By that time, the worst of the ep was over. Those who were going to die had died, and they were getting food. And I knew I had to get back to my unit because we were going to be moving around doing assorted things. I got tapped later on. The fighting was over. They broke up the combat units. And I was assigned to it because I was Major Medical Corps, fluent German, 7th Army Headquarters in Heidelberg. I got assigned to an occupation job. First, I was made commanding officer of a separate medical battalion. We were going to go on to fight the Japanese, help fight the Japanese in the China-Burma-India theater. We were retraining as much as you could train for China in Sinsheim, Germany. And then the big bomb got dropped. So we knew it was over. So then I got assigned to an occupation job. I was in charge of civilian venereal disease in southwest Germany. I had to set up 4,000 civilian venereal disease beds in southwest, go into the bombed out cities, find beds, find hospitals, round up doctors from the German prisoner of war cages and try and supply them. It was kind of a chaotic job. But I got to visit with the Germans and talk with them a lot.
What did you learn from that?
And what I learned from that is I don't know if the biggest bunch of liars or deniers or just myopic people in the world. The attitudes of the Germans, rarely did they feel a lot of guilt about what had happened. There was an attitude to blame everybody else, especially in the Rhineland. That was the Rhinegebiet north of Heidelberg, went up to Neckar toward the Rhine. It was known as a hotbed of Nazi political activity in that part of Germany. Down in Bavaria, there had been resistance. When we took the city of Munich, we surrounded Munich, the 3rd Division took it, but our scouts met people from a resistance outfit called the Bavarian Actions Unit, Bayerische Actionsfreiheit, who came out and said that they were trying to take over the city from the Nazis. Bavaria was, there was more of a resistance. The Rhineland was hotbed Nazi country. And the standard lines I heard were, we never suspected anything. We didn't know what was going on. How could we possibly dream of such a thing? No question of denying it. And the other thing we learned was, well, we're only little people. We're just little people. What could we do about it?
How was that for you, hearing that? How did you react to that when they told you that?
Well, one reaction I had was in the bookstore in Dachau. I wrote about this in my book. The young Yugoslav wanted to get a German-English dictionary. Because he was studying language.
We have to stop the tape, and we'll continue with that story in the next tape.
Yeah.
Liberator is Dr. Brendon Phibbs, and the date is January 19, 1997. Dr. Phibbs, we left off on the last tape. You entered a bookstore in Dachau.
And the young Yugoslav, Tito Miner, wanted a book. So I had my carbine or a .45 or some kind of weapon with me, I remember that day. Because we just took what we wanted pretty much in Germany at that point in the war. And we went in and I found, I said, "Ich will ein Wörterbuch, Deutsch English, I want a dictionary." He went and got it. And I said, "That's militarily requisitioned for the inmates of Dachau." Psh, signed. Before that had happened, however, when we first walked in, this man was kind of an evil-looking little soul. It looked like Goebbels, the propaganda minister, I remember thinking. He was talking to some other Germans. And they were talking about, well, the goddamn fuss all these Americans are making out that camp. They got rid of some Jews. What are they making all this, pure Nazi propaganda going on. But they almost purified the race, and now they're going to liberate these Jews, and that they are all the bad things about Jews and the people in the camp, and obvious, overt Nazi sentiments. So I let them talk, and finally he said, "Grüß dich Gott, meine Herren, greet God." That's how you say in Bavaria, like good day. "Ich bin Major Phibbs, Oberstabsarzt." I said, "The Amerikanische Sicherheitsdienst." Sicherheitsdienst would be security services. Of course I wasn't, I was a doctor, but they didn't know that. And I said, "That's from Hickson's interesting." That was extremely interesting. Oh my God, they fell apart. "Oh, no, you know, we're just the little people. We didn't understand." I heard the same lines over, and I told them what a bunch of damn liars they were. I went and got they gave them a short lecture in my spirited German. I wrote the receipt for the inhabitants of Dachau, gave it to the man as we walked out, and I said, "Balt, come to Amerikanische Sicherheitsdienst. The security boys will be home to see you." He was in terror. Didn't do anything except let me release some feelings, but it felt good. But this was epitomized. The Germans as a group, I must say, at least that generation, maybe they don't know what the word guilt means. If you treated them nicely, they deserved it. See, then we didn't do anything bad. See how nice they're being to us. That was the kind of tortured logic they used. If you treated them badly, you were being mean. We are noble Germans and we're being maltreated. It's a funny mindset I saw in that country, believe me. I've never seen anything quite like it anywhere. We in the Western world have a healthy sense of guilt which we employ to keep ourselves relatively honest, but it's unknown. And the other thing is, if the government said it, it's right. They failed as they failed. I talked to German teenagers during the occupation. Of course, like teenagers anywhere, they were against the establishment, the establishment having been Nazis, they were terrified to be it, but they were subterraneanly against it. So I explained Thoreau's essay on civil disobedience to them. And I'd say, manchmal ist Dienst nichts zu dienen. Sometimes it is your duty not to obey. Now, that was a shattering concept to these guys. There's a higher right and wrong above any politician, Thoreau's message. And you better be ready to obey that. But by and large, I found it a pretty sick culture and mindset. They were pliable. They had been enthusiastic Nazis, enthusiastic racists. They went along very thoroughly with everything the Nazis prescribed. And there were brave Germans, but they were dead. The Nazis, I found when I in my occupation time there talking, had gone through every city, every block, every house. And anybody with any pretensions to being liberal or anti-Nazi, to having any opposition to their philosophy, was eradicated. So, I mean, that country was purged of all the decent elements, house by house, block by block, and city by city. So a kind of swift, nasty Darwinian selection took place, anti-Darwinian selection took place. The brave people, the conscientious people, were killed or exiled.
Did you ever encounter any allied POWs?
Oh, many. And they were starved almost as badly as not as badly as the inmates of the concentration camp, but they were starved. The Germans were brutal to our allied POW. We liberated many of them. And they make them march 25 miles a day on almost no food. They were staggering, starving. And in the camps, We sent Red Cross packages to our prisoners, but only 1 out of 10 got there. The Germans took them. Just cold-bloodedly stole the Red Cross supplies supposed to go to our prisoners. One of my good friends who is now living in Casper, Wyoming, is a bombardier. Was shot down over Hungary and spent 2 years in a German prison camp. He's a short, thick-bodied man, but he told me when he went out, he could reach around his upper arm like that. Our prisoners, the Germans treated our prisoners very, very badly. And there were well-authenticated accounts of good. Another boy from the town I used to live in, Casper, Wyoming, was trying to, during the final days of the war, prisoners were wandering around aimlessly. And this particular group was trying to get to the American armies, and they were sleeping in a barn. And the SS surrounded the barn, set it on fire, and burned them to death, and machine gunned the ones. That was their favorite trick at that point.
Do you know if the Jewish American or black American soldiers were treated differently than the other POWs?
I don't know that for a fact. I think many of the Jewish American prisoners were, I am told, I don't know it firsthand, were actually put in concentration camps and treated like, they weren't treated as prisoners of war. But I don't know how common that was or how prevalent. I know it happened.
And did you ever encounter any soldiers of other Allied forces?
Oh, all the time. We were in the French First Army, so we had French, we had Algerians, we had Tunisians, we had the French Foreign Legion, believe it or not. We encountered the British.
Do you have any interactions you'd like to recall
at
all?
And the Russians. And we got along very well. The interaction with the French consists of a lot of horse trading with the Algerians. The boys with these long cloaks, you know, and belts of ammunition over it and turbans. Back in the February fighting, and they're just, you know, they're great traders. And here are ignorant farm boys from Illinois who start trading cigarettes for booze or something. And they came back wondering what happened to them because they would outfox them out of everything. But they're interesting people, friendly people. The French regular army people were stuffy in the extreme. We never understood them at all. When during the occupation, I was driving back through the French zone, which was down in the Black Forest. And I saw a sign saying, Le chasse est réservé pour l'officier général. There was great hunting in the German forest. We'd shoot deer and stuff. This sign said, hunting is reserved for general officers. That would have caused a mutiny in the American army, as you can well imagine. If we saw a deer, we shot it regardless of their signs, because they weren't about to argue with the Americans. But you could sense the old Vichy French type of mentality in the French regular army people. You can see where the French anti-Semitism had been so devastating in World War II, when they the milice, that's the Vichy militia, rounded up Jews and resistance people. You encounter that when you talk to them. We saw a lot of the British in England, of course, and occasionally Lee's. We never had much contact with them. We were so far south. We saw lots of Yugoslavian liberated people, and lots of Russians marching home, some of them. We saw every race there was, every kind of soldier there was. It was an incredible experience.
You worked during the occupation for how long did you?
Oh, that was just till November.
And then what did you do?
Then I came home.
So you returned back to the United States
came
when?
Came to the United States in November 1945.
And what was your rank at that time?
Major.
And were you discharged or did
then
you
I
stay?
Was discharged and to Camp Grand, Illinois. And got lined up. I'd written back to my old chief of service at St. Luke's Hospital in Chicago and said, if I live through this, I'd like to be a resident in medicine. I knew I wanted to take training in cardiology later. So I was a resident in internal medicine. And then because I had a lot of experience and I had an advanced degree in physiology besides my MD, they made me a research fellow my second year. passed my specialty board and then went on to take training in cardiology in Chicago.
And came back, and then you had a family, is that correct?
Penny and I had our first two children before I sailed overseas. Hank was born just before my division sailed. We had a frantic scramble to get them home to my father's house in Winnetka. I grabbed a plane, flew to Camp Barkley, and caught my division as we sailed for France, for England, France. And we had two more children afterwards.
And their names are?
Well, the two born before we went over were Susie, who was born in Camp Campbell, and Hank, who was born in Camp Barkley, Henry. He's an attorney now in Jackson Hole. And then after the war, over the years, we had two more children, Judy and Hugh. We're typical baby boomers with a lot of kids.
And then you became a cardiologist?
Yes. And I taught at Northwestern and practiced in Chicago and the part-time faculty at Northwestern. And then because I'm an outdoors man and worked in Wyoming and liked the West, I didn't like commuting around Chicago very much. I looked around the Northern Rockies, and there was the first multi-specialty clinic was getting started in the state there. They had a pediatrician from Harvard, an internist from Michigan, a physician from Columbia, PNS, and so on. That looked like fun. So I went out there in 1952 to Casper, Wyoming. And there was only one other internist. He and I were partners. Slowly organized a heart lab, bit by bit. And by the time I got through, we had the heart lab in the state of Wyoming. We had huge programs going for prevention of rheumatic heart disease in school children, things like that. I wrote my first textbook on the cardiac arrhythmias. I was on the part-time faculty at the University of Colorado. I used to fly down after enough years when I was well enough established every other Tuesday night and spend Wednesday teaching at the university and sitting in on the conferences and so on. And spent 20 years there, very happy years. All the kids got raised and through college. And then I'd written two books by then and a number of papers, so people kind of knew who I was. I let it be known in the academic circuit that I was interested in going to a full-time academic position. And Dr. Frank Marcus called me from Tucson and said, we're organizing a new medical school at the University of Arizona. Our university hospital opens next year. How would you like to join us and be in charge of electrocardiograph and the kind of thing I'd written about? So make a long story short, I moved here. And I've been here ever since, 25 years now.
Did you keep in touch with any of the people you liberated at all?
No way to do it. It was just chaos in that point in Europe. We didn't know where they went. They didn't know where they were going. And some of them I'd love to talk to and find out if they lived. But don't forget, Europe was the mob of displaced people. Half the world was wandering around there in herds, in and out of this kind of camp and that kind of camp, trying to get them relocated. And I can't imagine what's happened to them all.
What would you like to say to those who deny the occurrence of the Holocaust?
This is lunacy. It's like saying the sun doesn't come up in the east. It's something. This is the best witnessed and best documented crime in the history of the Western world. 2 million soldiers from the Allied armies, I would guess, at a rough estimate, walked through those camps and saw them. General Eisenhower saw them. General Patton saw them. Patton was a rough old bird, was so upset he vomited when he walked into one of the camps, Mauthausen or someplace. The Germans kept marvelous documents. With typical German thoroughness, they documented everything they did. There are war documented movies from the German Army Signal Corps of the executions by the Sonderkommandos on the Eastern Front when they lined people up by trenches and blew their brains out. There was no conceivable excuse for what we saw at Lunsburg. We saw it. I was there. I was there. Anyone who denies it, probably they're Nazis. There are a lot of Nazis in this country before World War II. On the near north side of Chicago, because I was studying German in college, a couple of friends and I would go to these beer halls on a Saturday night to speak colloquial German. They had Nazi flags. There was the DAWA, the Deutsche Amerikanische Wehrmacht Association. We hear them all talk about, by God, the race comes first, the nation comes second. Deep sympathies. The Milwaukee German beer families got Senator Joe McCarthy. You remember Joe McCarthy of ill fame? Well, the first thing he did before he started on his big red hunt, when he was a young senator, he got the Nazi SS murderers of the Malmedy massacre liberated and saved them from being hung. You know about the Malmedy massacre when they murdered 200 American prisoners. And he raised a typical McCarthy uproar, false charge, and it was just enough so that they didn't hang them. They went to jail. That's about all that happened. But there's this kind of, just as in France. France had the dry rot of anti-Semitism, reactionary royalism, which almost wrecked that country. The Germans took advantage of it. And French, I worked closely with the French underground. I didn't have time to tell you that in Alsace, because they're bilingual. And you'd sense this from then. That one reason France fell was that it was rotten down the core with this kind of reactionary racial hatred that split it, you know, the Dreyfus affair. Well, there was some of that in this country, not as much. And the people today who run around wearing Nazi armbands and yelling are doing the same kind of vicious, criminal, lunatic nonsense. They're trying to, and they're they're discrediting themselves when they do it. Because there can be no question about what happened. Too many million people saw it. Too many million people documented it. Anytime they want to check with the German government, they have the films are available in archives.
Do you keep in touch with anyone in your unit today?
Oh, all the time. We have an association called the 12th Armored Division Association. We have a meeting every year. And my particular friends in my unit, Bronk Zabrowski, nicknamed with Bronk, signal officer, who had a hairy job running around a light tank trying to keep the guns talking to the infantry. Lives in Green Bay, and he spends Christmas with us many times. He's a bachelor. One of our most decorated officers, Lucky Likens, as he's called, Ellery Likens, who got 2 silver stars, lives up in Colorado Springs, and he comes down here. And he went on to become a colonel in the regular army. As Liana says, he's the most polite man and also the toughest man she's ever met in his life. He won a silver star for calling down artillery fire on his own foxhole because the Germans were all around him. And he got on the radio and called it down. They said, but you're there, Lucky. He said, yeah, but I'm deeper than there. Bring it in. And he just stopped the whole German attack. Some of them have died, of course, but we're very close. We stay in close, very close touch.
Do you have reunions?
Reunions every year. I go whenever I can.
Is there a newsletter that comes out with?
We have a division newsletter. I have it right here, the 12th Armored Division Association News. You bet.
Is there one incident or memory that absolutely stands out in your mind during the time you spent in liberating Landsberg and Dachau? If I were to ask you, is there one image that comes across your mind? Do you know what that would be?
Yeah, the man who died of CNS typhus. This poor shriveled skeleton, racked by typhus, going into convulsions, bowing in this obscene arc, thing we used to call a wrestler's bridge in college when I wrestled. So that only the picture, the back of his head and his feet touching, the rest jerked into like a bowstring, you know, and then collapsing dead. And that was the epitome of everything these people did. All the German science, all the German industry all resulted in that poor shriveled hulk. I remember thinking that as I stood by his side.
Have you spoken to any groups or children or students about your experiences?
Oh, you bet, all the time. Everybody that will listen. And they're so well organized here in Tucson, I'm delighted to hear this, that I've talked to middle schools, I've talked to the university, I talk to the medical students. I give you a basic physiology lecture every year, and I end up with about 15 minutes on the concentration camps and the heroism of the Dutch physicians and the Royal Netherlands Medical Society, who saved at least 10,000 Jews by refusing to cooperate with the Germans at the risk of their necks, you know, at the risk of death.
What is your message to the students when you speak to them, when you lecture to them? What message do you want to give them?
The message is that racial hatred is the thin edge of a knife that ends in horror. Once you admit it a little at all, you end up with Dachau. You end up with the destruction of everything you ever believed in. And it's the worst germ that ever attacked the human body social. That's what I try to get across to them. That the America is a multiracial society, one of the few in the world, if you think about it. Multi-ethnic, multiracial. How do you define a race? You know, they argue. The anthropologists argue about it, but we know what we mean. Groups, people, ethnicity. And we have every color and every creed in the world here. We are unique in that way. And that to admit the poison of racial, ethnic hatred is the most un-American, subversive, traitorous thing they can do to the United States of America. That's what I tell them.
Have you ever written about your experiences?
Well, I have my book.
What is the name of your book?
It's The Other Side of Time, published by my friends at Little Brown & Company. It came out in 1983, and I'm happy to say it won the Penn West Award for nonfiction that year. The Book of the Month Club alternate. So it got around. I've had a couple of hateful letters from Nazi sympathizers in this country after they read my book, saying they just didn't believe the awful things I said about the Germans. And sending me stuff, anti-Holocaust literature, you know.
Did you respond to it?
I couldn't stand to. I didn't want to even think that such people existed.
Is there any message you would like to, or advice you would like to give to the world, to the future generations, before we end this interview? Is there any piece of advice after having witnessed what you did?
I guess I'd think of an encyclopedia of advice. It's hard to come down to one thing. But that the irrational fractionating hatred of another person because they look differently, think differently, go to a different shaped church, go to eat different food, the idea of fearing and hating another because they are, to use the simple word, different, is the most destructive element in human experience. It's led to the wars, the massacres, and they're all irrational and they have no basis in fact whatsoever.
Did you participate in any war crimes trials?
No. One of my patients and friends in Winnetka was a lawyer in the Nuremberg trial, but I followed them very closely. My chief at Northwestern, Dr. Ivy, the head of physiology, was on the committee that investigated medical atrocities. And he's a very famous man. I have a master's degree in physiology besides my MD, which I got by killing myself working while I went through medical school. And he talked to me at length about what he'd seen. And he came back and we were visiting after the war. You know, the maiming, the horrible experiments on pregnant women, the business of shaving a bone to see how thin they could make it so they would still bear weight if you stood on it. Incredible maiming, torturing, and pointless experiments carried out by quacks. You know, they didn't even have the possible redeeming virtue that this was major science by major scientists. It was lunacy carried on by quacks. Not only was it immoral in human terms, it was so ridiculous in scientific terms.
Before we end, is there anything else you would like to add or anything you feel you've forgotten to say? Or?
Gee, I don't think so. I'm just delighted you're doing this. Let me add that. You know, I'm 80. We're not going to be around that much longer in the course of nature. And please listen to us, everybody. Please record this, keep it, get it out, view it, listen to us. That's the message.
Well, Ivan, thank you very much for your interview.
Well, the story ends finally. After I was a widower for some 7 years, I married a colleague, a hospital administrator, a refugee from Cuba who had her own share of hardship and exile. My wife, Liana. Liana, look at the people and smile. For history.
Thank you very much.
All right, this is a picture of me in one of our light tanks, which we often use to haul wounded. In this case, I bummed a ride as they came back from shooting up Germans across the Danube. You can see the empty shell cases on the tank. And this is a picture of me after a very cold night in the woods. I'd slept on that pile of hay the night before, and that's my old ambulance in the background, tank column. This is the entrance to the concentration camp at Landsberg. You notice it says, danger of infection, entrance to the camp is forbidden. But even the Germans knew that. This is what we saw when we entered the camp, masses of dead bodies so thick that it was hard to walk anywhere without stepping on them. And the faces, as you can see here, many of them had been screaming terminally. You can see the mouths wide open, the shrunken faces, and the look of horror, especially on the third man in there. Here are many more of the dead bodies you saw, partially clad, strewn in every kind of disorder. And you notice the arms and legs here, that man's thigh in the middle of the picture is about as thick around as you'd expect someone's forearm to be, but that's a human thigh, incredibly thin. Here we saw these burned A-frames. We didn't know what they were at first. Notice the A-frame, a lot of ashes in them. We found out that that's where the prisoners had been penned up by their guards when they had orders to kill as many as they could before the Americans arrived. They threw gasoline on, set fire to them, and you can see here the bodies in one of the huts with the arms thrown up, obviously in agony. Charred dead bodies all over the place. This is what they look like. These were killed by 18 men of the German engineer group, Organization Tod. And this is what they looked like. It was hard to imagine the scale of all this, even though this wasn't not one of the bigger camps. Here you see German civilians from the town of Landsberg who were marched out to carry the dead and give them decent burial, guarded by one of our soldiers who was obviously enjoying making the Germans do this awful job. And you notice how well-fed and fit the Germans are compared to the pathetic corpse that they're carrying. More of the same, on and on and on, endlessly. Burned remains, dead people. And here's the burial that was organized by our division. You see the bodies laid out. And we had a rabbi, a Protestant minister, and a Catholic priest each read the services of the respective denominations. And then we had the Germans bury them. The least we could do for the poor people. You see a German prisoner of war standing there in the middle of the picture, still in his uniform. Now, this is the last picture I conclude with. This is a pretty sad, terrifying commentary on what we saw at the end of World War II.